Hello, my name is Rob Aiken. I'm a distinguished architect in the EDA group at Synopsys. I'm joined by Shekhar Kapoor, who manages many of our EDA products and solutions and leads Synopsys Multi-Die Initiative. Also, Manmeet Walia, who manages a broad portion of our IP portfolio. And Rita Horner, who works with our customers and ecosystem partners to create complex system designs. Over the next few minutes, we'll explore the move to multi-die system design. We'll look at some challenges, strategies to meet those challenges, and see what awaits us as a result. Over the past couple of years, we've seen a lot of interest in design and deployment of multi-die semiconductor systems. And while the overall design process and supporting ecosystem are still in development, some organizations are forging ahead nonetheless. So what's driving the move to multi-die system design? Why is it happening now?
So Rob, at the very core of it is the innovation demand. Is that insatiable thirst for faster, better, and smarter. And in that, you know, the need and drive to really cram and fit more and more functionality, and with that, more user experiences in the products and services. So up until now, you know, the digital side, we really relied on the Moore's Law-driven scalability as a lever to really deliver towards this innovation demand, but that's flattening out, as we know. You're not really getting the bang for the buck that you were with the technology advances year over year in the last many years or decades. So the challenge that you have is you cannot continue to grow the chips in sizes and continue to fit more and more stuff into it because there is this prohibitive. The challenges that you face because of power, performance, reticle size limits, and even the yield challenges, those make it very complicated and very cost ineffective, if I may. So on the other side that, you know, to give those experiences that I talked about, you have this sensing and analog components, but they don't map very well to the advanced technology, and they don't scale as well as the digital in any case. Mm-hmm. So what are you really looking at? It's kind of a perfect storm situation over here. On one side, you want to continue to scale as an answer to these growing compute demands, and you want to be able to build all these highly complex, heterogeneous type of products with analog and digital all coalesced together. But you cannot do that anymore. So you need a different answer, and that answer is multi-die approach.
Okay, that makes sense. Manmeet, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, so it's primarily the physics and some economics of that is leading to the multi-die systems, or what we call now as the SysMoore era, emergence of the SysMoore era. So let's look at some examples of the physics of multi-die systems. One example is scaling small compute dies to make a big compute system. So this is for high performance compute system. You can also create multiple SKUs out of it. So one compute die goes in a laptop, two compute dies would go in a desktop, four compute dies would make a server, and so on. The other example of this would be disaggregating the IOs and other analog functions and implementing them in the process nodes that are best optimized for these complex high-speed IOs and the analog functions. So these are, again, some examples of how the physics is leading to multi-die systems. Mm-hmm. The other side, some piece of it is also economics. For example, reuse, right? So with reuse, you get better time to market and you lower your risk. Another example could be disaggregating a big die, which is approaching the max reticle size, hence the yields are going down, right? So you can split a big die, and hence you can get a better yield and a better cost out of that. So it's primarily the physics, a little bit economics, that's leading to the multi-die systems.
All right, thanks, Manmeet. So Rita, what are you seeing with our customers? Is multi-die system design something that's starting to gain momentum?
We're already working with quite a few customers in integrating high bandwidth memory along with their processors or compute die in one package. We started with one die, one memory stack, and now we have moved into integrating multiple die of memory stack along with multiple die of compute die in the same package.
So Shekhar, how does design methodology fit into all this? Clearly there's got to be some things that need to be done differently to build these multi-die systems.
So Rob, yes and no. The design methodology, actually, a lot of it is still the same. In that sense, it's more of an evolutionary than revolutionary, I would say. But of course, the scope of the problem is bigger. The scale is also bigger. And end of the day, what you're trying to build is a very large heterogeneous integration multi-die system. Essentially, actually, if you look at it, it's the way our customers talk about it, it's a chip scale-out problem.
Yeah.
And the goal is to really very seamlessly transition from 2D to this multi-die system. They're very used to 2D, but multi-die system, even though it's the same kind of design flow and journey, but the challenges are more profound in each of those steps. What you're trying to achieve is the optimality, system optimality, and of course the performance, and you also trying to achieve the system reliability, and all very efficiently.
Right.
So it really starts very early on, all in the architectural exploration state, I would say. That's where you laying the seeds for a very solid foundation and to achieve the optimality of the system that you would try to shoot for. So what you're trying to do is actually start from hardware, software, splitting and partitioning to meet your architectural spec and any KPIs that you might have in terms of performance, bandwidth, and latency. And so you might end up dealing with is that you might have tens to hundreds of different dies in the system to achieve that architecture spec that you have in mind. And that then brings, you know, the hundreds of millions of connections that you have to deal with in this system. And that's the optimization problem, which is, you know, nowadays we are, of course, looking at the AI-driven workflows to address those optimization problems in throughout our technologies. So how do we address it? We have a suite of tools starting upfront, starting from platform architecture, for example, which allows you to really look at all these realistic workloads and see what's the best way to partition the design upfront. And this goes hand in hand with our software core verification and validation technologies, which kind of work in concert to really accelerate this going from this architecture idea all the way to the physical solution. And soon after that, you have, now you get into the design stage. That's the next step in your journey. Now what you're trying to do is that take those, crystallize those physical solutions that you have architected and make them physical realities and progressing the optimization. One of the key things which is appearing up in a multi-die system as unique to it is this power and thermal challenges, which have sort of become the first order effects. And these are again the constraints that you have to start looking at very early on in the architectural stage. What we've done in this area is that we partnered with Ansys. It's a very close partner with us, and we married, brought in the best technologies that we have, for example, the Synopsys sign-off technologies like PrimeTime and StarRC, and we brought in the best-in-class solutions from Ansys in terms of signal integrity, thermal integrity, and power integrity, and we've embedded them in the design flow, which is fusion design flow at the 3D IC compiler, which allows you to really converge while looking at all these different constraints. And in this journey, is one of the critical things which has emerged, the high-value problem that we talk about is the manufacturing side.
Right.
The end of the journey, but nevertheless very important. And that's where the system testability and reliability come into the picture. So in that sense, we're not just talking about taking all the known good dies and putting together in an amalgamated single package.
Yeah.
But it's really ensuring the health of the system through its life cycle and all the way into the in-field operation. So this is, again, a critical area of focus for Synopsys. We have many solutions like the extended test max, as well as a portfolio of silicon lifecycle management with tools, IP, and analytics to help you get through that journey and actually build the products which are manufacturable and reliable in the field. So you can see, I mean, you know, the way I would summarize is a long answer to the question, yeah. Rob, that it's the same journey, but steps are more involved. There are more constraints which come into the picture, and you need a kind of a more holistic solution, really from silicon to software point of view.
Thanks, Shekhar. That's quite a laundry list there. So you talked about co-verification. Tell me more about co-verification of hardware and software.
Yeah, Rob, that's actually a very good point, and thanks for asking that. You know, when we think about the multi-die systems, actually it's just not the hardware. It's the software and the hardware. And multi-die systems actually have a lot of software. Each of these dies could have its own software stack. And verifying this software in the context of the hardware that it's going to run on is very important.
Yeah.
But this verification, let's not underestimate it. The verification challenge, the co-verification challenge is just pretty big. And why is that? You know, as I said, that each of the die in the multi-die system can have its own software stack. And actually each of these dies can have a completely different profile in terms of the spec that it has, the interfaces it has, and the constraints it has. And more importantly, it could be all in the different development life cycle. So if you look at the whole verification space, in order to co-verify a system which each of these dies or species could be in the different life cycle, you need a kind of a mix and match approach, which really means you need to have an approach where you can take actual chiplets and you can take the models, virtual, prototype, or emulation models, and bring it all together in a platform where you can co-verify and co-validate this. And that's what, you know, we've been trying to look at, you know, how we can have this systems which allow you to do that. We had very successful solutions available for the multi-die, for the 2D chip, for the monolithic chip, and we've really invested and expanded them to enable this complicated, more complex verification problem for the multi-dies. We have solutions like Virtualizer with probably the largest System C IP library. There is a HAPS prototype system, which allows you to do high-speed I/O verification as well as mixed voltage support and more. And then, of course, we have the ZeBu and ZeBu hybrid emulation platform with a very high scalability, which allows you to really handle many, many use cases that you're going to encounter in a complex system like that. And one additional point I would like to add is with so many pieces in a multi-die system, it could be a very compute-intensive challenge.
Yeah.
And that's where we have a solution like ZeBu Hybrid Cloud, which allows you to do this is really get access to this hardware whenever you need it to perform this, you know, much high capacity, much high scalable validation that you need to do without actually having to buy it outright. So overall, if you think about it, this is a heterogeneous problem. Yeah. You need a heterogeneous, flexible solution with many pieces coming together, coupled together, to really enable this co-verification, co-validation.
Thanks, that makes a lot of sense. Manmeet, we hear a lot about chiplets these days. What are chiplets? What is Synopsys doing to enable this trend?
So this term chiplet has evolved to have many meanings to it. Actually, at Synopsys, we like to call it multi-die systems. But let me answer this in the context of what we see in this growing design community. The single biggest use case of chiplets as we see today is around I/O disaggregation. Think about a high-speed, super complex 112 gig PHY on one side and a die-to-die interface on the other side. So this is now, the I/Os are disaggregated and they can now be connected to a main compute die or whatever else.
Right.
Now, there are two things that are extremely important here. One is standardization around IPs like UCIe. Mm-hmm. And what they drive in turn is the electricals, the compliance, the interop, the form factors, etc. Mm-hmm. And the second thing that's very important here is the methodology along the lines of top-level partitioning, software development, testability, silicon lifecycle management, and so on. And together, these two things will then drive the overall chiplet ecosystem.
Thanks, Manmeet. I think this has been a great discussion. It's time for our final words. Manmeet, you go first.
Yeah, so a chiplet ecosystem is critical to the multi-die systems. An ecosystem will enable the multi-die systems and make it accessible to all, just like the foundries made monolithic dies accessible to all the semiconductor companies. At Synopsys, we have the IPs, we have the IP subsystems, and we have all the tools to enable the IP chiplet ecosystem as well. So we are working to enable our customers with the chiplet ecosystem.
Excellent, I'm looking forward to that ecosystem. Rita, what would you like to add?
Multi-die system is definitely one of the few options left for the high-end performance computing environment to be able to continue with the 2x performance improvement from generation to generation close by,
yeah,
without multi-year gaps, while keeping the power in check and latency in check. That's really pretty much what would enable us on the high-end technologies to be able to maintain the momentum while keeping the power and latency and be able to manufacture. Now, this solution is not simple, it's quite complex. And in order for it to move beyond just a very few high-end designers, it would need an ecosystem to support it. And generally, for anything to take off and be able to be adopted more broadly, it would require a group of organizations, such as JEDEC, who had established the JED environment for the adoption of the HBM solution, integration in a package, as well as now we have organizations such as the ODSA part of OCP, or the UCIE consortium, along with all their partners and members who are working jointly to make this a reality, to address both the technical and the business aspect, the challenges that these users will be facing, and ironing the way so they can actually have more and more broader adoption across the market.
Very good. So we're building the ecosystem and pushing forward and participating in this broader project across the industry.
Exciting times, definitely.
Very good, yeah. Shekhar, you got the last word.
Thank you, Rob. Yeah, I'll recap, I think, what we discussed today over here. So if you look back, you know, over the years, Synopsys has really enabled many design approaches, have given impetus to many different productivity ways, which has resulted in, I would say, very transformative products. For us, you know, the way we see this is a silicon to software problem. It spans the whole technology around it, and that has been our focus. So what we're witnessing now is actually a complete change, a paradigm shift, and a new norm, new way to do this semiconductor chips moving forward. And I think reiterate what Rita just said, that, you know, this is going to be the way moving forward. Multi-die systems is the way. If you want to get the maximum performance and the maximum, the most optimal design that you're trying to achieve. And what are we doing? Adding to what both Manmeet and Rita said, we are actually invested deeply. We're really catalyzing the entire ecosystem. And all these solutions that we talked about, we are enabling many marquee customers to go through this journey, again, from the monolithic chip to the multi-die system. But we also believe, you know, we have to acknowledge this is only the beginning of the journey. Right? You know, it's only the tip of the iceberg that we are looking at. There's much, much more to do, much more to achieve. As a matter of fact, I'm very curious how the widespread use of AI in the context of multi-die could really change the game even more. So the only thing I would say is that, you know, the boundaries of this whole possibilities are profound. It'll continue to move forward to help us get to this even smarter tomorrow.
Well put. So thanks, everybody. That was a great discussion, and thanks for coming and joining us.
Thank you, Ron.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rita.
Thank you for making it happen.